to the word of God.
Yeah.
It is good to see them perform here in the sanctuary. It is even better if we leave tonight and get away as you go. Not just in the performance that they do, but in the life that they lead. The life they will be living as they leave these four walls and journey out into the world. Because Satan is there. He's there too.
Yeah.
But he's there. So it's up to us, to keep our arms around and watch over them and lead them in the right direction. You know, I've heard so much talk about the thing that the Supreme Court did and how it affected people. We all have our own opinion. But one thing I would ask you to look at and is what the Bible said. The Bible tells us that we are in this world, but not of this world. If we live by what the Bible tells us to live, then we do what we're supposed to do.
That's right.
The world has got their own agenda. We can be upset, but as long as we don't affect the church, you know, I'm all right with it.
Amen.
It's because I know what God has told me to do and the way He has told me to live my life. I'm going to try to do it that way.
All right.
So as long as I try to do it that way, me and my Lord are on the turn. Good morning again.
Good morning.
And we welcome all of you here this morning. Our pastor is, I think, in Chicago. He's up there and they installed a new pastor, a friend of his. So, you were left with me this morning. I started out this morning with a big smile and on my face, messing with people like I always do. But, you know, Satan has a way of raising his ugly head. But you're not going to take my joy this morning.
All right.
I'm not going to do that this morning. So, if you have your Bibles with you this morning, I'd like for you to turn to Acts of the Apostles, chapter 2. Starting at verse 1. And it reads,
Wait a minute.
Oh, you ain't got it yet, huh? Acts is the first epistle after the Gospel of John. For you Bible students. Like the pastor was saying, I think it was last week, we come out of Genesis, so you can be hard to find. Okay. And it reads. Everybody there?
Yeah.
Okay. And it reads. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind. And it was filled, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire. And one sat upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, I come to you this morning realizing, Father, that I am just a vessel that you use, Father. There's nothing great about me, Father. It's all you. So, Father, I ask that you use me this morning. Use me in a way that I can speak to these your children, Father. And, Father, let me decrease while you increase. And speak through me and to me that these your people can hear from on high. Now let the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
We, this morning, will talk about that person that we know as the Holy Spirit. The Spirit brings life. You know, there's a story that was going around that Jesus, when he returned to heaven as the exalted reigning Christ, some of the angels and others of the heavenly hosts were curious about his earthly journey. They questioned him about his accomplishments. They asked, did you start a great movement? Did you lead a great army? How many followers did you have? Jesus replied to them, I generally attracted good crowds, but I only had 12 disciples and a few friends and dedicated followers. Well, they said, if there were so few, they must have been exceptional human beings with sterling characters. They had to be leaders in their communities and successful in their careers. To this, Jesus replied, no, they were regular, ordinary people.
All right.
See, there was a tax collector, several fishermen, just common working people. Evidently, they must have been very flawed, the others said. Jesus said, I believe they wanted to be, but in my hour of crisis, one betrayed me, another denied me, and almost all of them fled. They responded to Jesus and said, and yet you expect this group to carry on your work. And Jesus said, yes, I do. Surely, they said, you must have an alternate plan. No, Jesus said, I have no alternate plan. But you must have another group in reserve somewhere in the event this one failed. Jesus said, this group is the only one that I am depending on. You see, because this group is my church.
All right.
You know, as unstable and unreliable as we are, as easy as we become discouraged and distracted, as quickly as we become tired and ready to give up, as often as we incline to complain and engage in self-pity, as weak and unworthy as we are, as stubborn as we are, and as determined as we are to walk in our own willful way, the fact remains that Christ had committed and entrusted the ongoing work of the kingdom into our own very hands. Any casual reading of the New Testament will reveal that the Lord left his work in some very shaky hands. It was left in the hands of the disciples, who determined and demonstrated time and time again that they were unworthy and should not be trusted. To the very end, Peter continued to leap before he looked and speak before he thought. To the end, Judas maintained a secret agenda, while Thomas openly voiced his skepticism. Philip asked foolish questions, while James and John tried to plot and politic their ways to the two top spots in the kingdom. Yet these were the ones who had been entrusted with the task of proclaiming salvation to a lost and sinful world. You see, the church that Christ left was a disappointing church. Those whom the Master called had different concepts and different expectations of his Messiahship than they did. They expected Jesus to set up an earthly kingdom, and they saw themselves on earthly thrones. They had hope that Jesus would redeem Israel, but his teaching, coupled with Calvary, had shattered their very hopes. The church also that Christ left was a confused church. How could Jesus allow himself to be crucified? They had seen Jesus rebuke raging storms, cast out demons, heal the sick, and even raise the dead. They knew that he could call legions of angels to fight his battle. So why could he submit to Calvary? Their confusion was the confusion of all faithful people when they see goodness abused and crucified by the hands of evil. Only when life seems to contradict all that they believe about a just and powerful and good God. The church that Christ left was also a weakened church. Their fellowship had been virtually destroyed by division, betrayal, desertion, and denial. Satan had shown that the disciples, all of them, had clay feet, that none of them could be counted on when the chips were down. Most of them had been shamed by their behavior on the night that Jesus was betrayed. And none of them could feel quite the same about themselves. Their self-confidence, their perception of who and what they were had been shaken. The church that Christ left was a frightened church. It was a church that hid itself behind closed doors. Now that Jesus had been crucified, they said, what now will happen to us? Jesus had already told them that the servant was not greater than the master, nor the messenger greater than the sinner. Jesus told them that if the world hated and rejected him, it would also hate and reject them. Having seen what happened to Jesus, they feared
for their own lives. The church that Christ built was a lifeless church. It was a church in mourning. They had lost the physical presence of the one who was their integrating center. They had lost the one who had called them from where they were and brought them all together. They had lost the one who had given them life. To be sure, the church that Christ left was all of this, but it also was more than this. The church that Christ left was also a believing church, a hopeful church, a trusting church, an expecting church. With all that had happened to their little group, with all their disappointments, confusion, weakness, fear, and personal loss, they still believed Christ's promises, and they followed His command. There were some things that Satan couldn't destroy, and the world couldn't touch. There were some things they could still trust, and Christ's promise ranked high among them. You see, Christ's promises were about all they had left to cling to. The Lord had promised them a comforter. He had promised power, and they had never known Christ to lie. When they thought about it, they remembered that Christ had told them that this time would come. He told them that He would be rejected, and He would suffer, and He would be killed. Jesus told them that when the shepherd was stricken, the sheep would scatter. Jesus told them that they would have tribulations in this world. But He said also to be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. You see, earlier on the third morning, while it was still dark, Jesus, just as He said, rose from the grave. Christ had always kept His promise. Therefore, in spite of all that had happened, the disciples continued to believe. Sometimes all we have to go on is our experience in trusting God's word. Sometimes life's circumstances will contradict all that we believe. We don't know what the future holds. Sometimes the only thing we have left is our knowledge of what Jesus has done in our lives. How He has stood with us, fought battles for us, and opened doors for us. But if we can just remember that the Lord has always kept His promise, and His promise, and He has always promised to be with us. He would never leave us alone. It gives us reason to keep hoping and trusting and praying and believing. You see, the church that Christ left assembled itself together during the time of the feast known as the Feast of the Week or Pentecost. Pentecost means 50 days, and it was celebrated on the 50th day after the beginning of the Jewish Passover. It was essentially known as an agricultural feast, where the Jews presented unto the Lord their first fruit of the labor. However, it later became associated with the reading of the law, because it was believed that Moses received the law at Mount Sinai and delivered it to the people on the 50th day after the Passover. Jesus had been crucified during the Passover season. He had walked among the disciples for 40 days after His resurrection. Then for 10 days, the church had gathered in the upper room to receive the promise. It had been 50 days since the Lord had been resurrected, and the promise had not yet come. But still, they believed. Sometimes simply assembling together in expectation is an act of faith in and of itself. Thus, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, on the 50th day, when Jews customarily assembled themselves in the synagogue and temple to hear the law. On the day when the law had been lifted up, the Holy Spirit baptized the church with power. The Holy Spirit established itself as the guide and force and power in the life of the church. Let us never forget that Christ not only keeps his promise, but his promises are always perfectly timed. Sometimes we try to hurry the Lord to deliver before the proper time. Sometimes we think that the Lord has moved too late or after the proper time. But the Lord always moves on time, and his promises always kept in perfect time. The old folks used to say, he might not come when you want him, but he always on time. When the Holy Spirit came, the saints was all assembled. They were not scattered here or there, with one doing his or her grief thing over here, and another one doing his or her guilt thing over there. They were all in one place. Power can come to saints when they assemble together in the name of Jesus. God gave us each other because we need each other. There is power in the communion of the saints. Individually, no matter how strong you think you are, you still can be broken. But when the church come together and pray together, not even the gates of hell can prevail against us. Not only was the church in one place, but when the Holy Spirit came, the church was on one accord. It is possible for the church to assemble in a spirit of discord. When the church assembles in a contrary spirit, it can lose its identity as the church because it begins to look and act and talk like everybody else. But when the church is in unity, when the church is in a spirit of love, when the church is on one accord in the spirit, it's time. It can really be the church, because then the Holy Spirit can flow most freely. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. We can't program or time the Holy Spirit. We can't work him up or bring him in. We can't turn him on or turn him off. Now we may do that with our own spirit, but not with the Holy Spirit. For the Holy Spirit is like the wind. It blows where it will. We hear the sound thereof. We are moved by his forces and refreshed by his breezes, but we can't tell from which it comes or where it goes. The Spirit comes as his own accord, suddenly, and falls where it will. The only thing we can do is prepare ourselves to receive him when he comes. On the day of Pentecost, when the church was in one place and on one accord, suddenly the Holy Spirit came. When the Spirit came, four things happened to the church. They heard, they saw, they were filled, and they spoke. They heard a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind. They were filled with the house where they were all assembled. They looked and they saw cloven tongues of fire that sat upon each of them. Fire of clearing and cleansing, fire of destruction and purification, fire of the melting and kindling, fires of burning up and burning through. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. You know, two bodies can't occupy the same space at the same time. But when the Holy Spirit, they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. Their disappointment gave way to joy. Their confusion revelation, to clear perception, the weakness to strength, the fear to courage, the loss to love. The Spirit gave them new life, and they spoke in other tongues, and the Spirit gave them utterance. The tongues in which they spoke were not gibberish, but intelligible language. Jerusalem was filled that day with people from all over the world who were there to celebrate the Jewish Pentecost. When they heard the shouts of praises from the one church on one accord and one Holy Spirit, they understood what they were saying, for they asked, "How can this be? These men are from Galilee, and yet we hear them speaking in our various native tongues. We hear them in our own native language, proclaiming the mighty works of God." And when they sought the meaning of it all, there were those in the crowd who tried to make light of the Spirit's work by saying they were just drunk from drinking new wine. There will always be those who will not understand or appreciate or choose not to be part of the movement of the Holy Spirit. There will always be those who try to mock the movement. But if one is truly anointed with the Spirit that falls from above, God will give an answer and have a holy boldness to proclaim it. You see, Peter stood up and said they were not drunk. It was only 9 o'clock in the morning. Too early for me drunk. This is which what was spoken by the prophet Joel, who said, "And it shall come to pass in the last day, said God, I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh." Not just bishops, elders, evangelists, deacons, but all flesh. Not just big names, big givers, church pillars, leading families, but all flesh. Not the rich, the educated, the privileged, the mighty, but all flesh. Not just adults and children and elders, but all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. And it shall come to pass that whosoever call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. There is a story of an English Puritan named John Bunyan, who once saw in a vision a man throwing water on a flame of fire, and yet the flame continued to burn. He wondered how the flame could keep on burning until he saw someone behind the door pouring oil on the fire. You know, I'm so glad that when this world tried to drown out my flame, the Holy Spirit is there to keep pouring oil on the fire. Fire to purify me. Fire to separate me. Fire to energize me. Fire to set me ablaze. Fire till the Holy Spirit can take control. So a fire, so when I come up here to preach to you, you don't come to hear me preach. You come to see me burn up. So let the fire burn. Sometimes I feel the Spirit, and it seems like my work and my living is in vain. But the Holy Spirit reminds me that I am a special in the eyes of the Lord. You see, in spite of my sin, God saved me. In spite of my filth, God cleansed me up. He picked me up and turned me around and set my feet on solid ground. You see, He's my stay in times of trouble, in my peace, in the storm of life. He's my bridge over troubled waters. He's my joy in times of sadness. He's the light unto my path. He's my way out of no way. And yes, he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. You don't know, church, but I am heir into the kingdom of God. My brother, his name is Jesus, and he's my Lord and Savior, and he's my path to eternal life. Let us not forget that the Holy Spirit is in this world. Life to a dying world. Jesus said that he would send a comforter. And he did. And that comforter dwells in you. If you are a child of God. You know, that's why a lot of times I say that we are worse off than those who lived back in Jesus' time. We have the Holy Spirit in us. Way back before Jesus, it was on them. The Holy Spirit came on. But it's in us to lead and guide. To lead and guide us each and every day. And it lets you know when you agree with the Holy Spirit. I think once they say it's conscious of that, but the Holy Spirit is there to guide you each and every day. And if you listen to it, you will never be in trouble. It's a scripture that I used to say, I hear people say, you hear people quote this, the Lord will not put more on you than you can stand. Find that in the scripture for me. Scripture says, the Lord will not allow you to be tempted more than you can stand. And with that temptation, he will allow a way to escape. That's the Holy Spirit speaking to you. And that's in Corinthians. A smart lady got on me about that. Her name was Sister Walker.
Amen.
We're always trying to correct me when I was doing things wrong. Anyway, I pray that something was said this morning that would help someone in a daily Christian walk. And at this time, I'm not going to do like President Obama and saying, or maybe I will. At this time, we opened the doors to the church. We was an invitation for anyone that do not have a church open. Tomorrow is not promised to you. Actually, the next second is not promised to you. Don't play with God. My father used to say there's only two places that you can spend eternity, and you're not going to be lucky to miss one of them. You're going to hit one of them. You're either going to spend it with the Lord, or you're going to spend it